Hello and welcome to this video lecture on the poem The Retreat by Henry Vaughan. I am Sanket Kumar Jha, Assistant Professor in English at Lalit Narayan Mithila University, Darbhanga, Bihar. In this video, we shall learn some facts about the poet Henry Vaughan and then move on to analyze this poem, its meaning, its structure and the use of poetic devices in it. For more videos related to English literature, please subscribe to my channel. Your questions, likes and comments are always welcome. The poet Henry Vaughan is a metaphysical poet of the 17th century. He came from Wales, a part of the United Kingdom. He himself admits English is a language the author was not born to. Vaughan attended Jesus College, Oxford and became interested in medicine, poetry, law and spirituality. He became a doctor also. He worked as a clerk to Judge Marmaduke Lloyd. During the Civil War of 1645, Vaughan was imprisoned and his property was seized because he supported the king. Vaughan was greatly influenced by the works of George Herbert, another metaphysical poet. They had some kinship between them also. But while Herbert is a religious poet, Vaughan is a mystic and a spiritual poet. The difference between religion and spirituality. Religion is the belief in the existence of a god or gods and the activities that are connected with the worship of them. It is a set of rules like Hinduism, Islam, Christianity, etc. Spiritual means connected with the human spirit rather than the body or physical things. Spirituality has no rules. It sets you free to become the best you can be. Hence, while Herbert celebrates the church, the place of religion in his poem, Vaughan is interested in mystical communion with nature. Works of Henry Vaughan. First, Poems with the 10th Satire of Juvenile English, published in 1646, Olor Iscanus, published in 1647, Silex Scintillans, published in 1650, and a second part published in 1655. Mount of Olives or Solitary Devotions, published in 1652, and Thalia Rediviva, a joint collection of poetry with his brother Thomas Vaughan, was published in 1678. Before analyzing the poem, let me ask you a question. Do you also feel that you were more happy when you were a child? This poem is based on the belief that we exist as souls in heaven before we are born on earth. Those who follow this belief also believe that babies are inherently sin-free as they have just come from heaven. The poet in this poem longs to return to that sin-free state of childhood. Vaughan's Silex Scintillans, the meaning of this title is a spark from the flint, contains his best known poems like The Retreat, The World and Departed Friends. Let us pay attention to the title of this poem, that is The Retreat. The term retreat has two meanings. It means moving away from a place or an enemy. When an army is defeated, it retreats. It means wapas hona. Retreat also means a quiet and private place away from the humdrums of our daily lives. In this sense, it means asre, a place to stay. In this poem, the poet makes use of both the meanings of the word retreat. He wants to retreat, that means to move away from the world and return to his retreat, that is God. Kavi vapas hona chahta hai is duniya se apne asre ke paas jo God hai. Such figure of a speech is called pun or play on words. The poem begins now. Happy those early days when I signed in my angel infancy before I understood this place appointed for my second race. Do you find something special in the first line, something uncommon? Happy those early days. Generally we say those early days were happy days. Yes, here the syntax is inverted. The poet has used inversion टू ऐड इम्फेसिस, कवि ने इम्फेसिस के लिए सिंटैक्स को उलट दिया है. हैप्पी हियर मीन्स ब्लेसेड. अर्ली डेज रिफर्स टू द चाइल्डहुड ऑफ द पोएट. द टर्म एंजल इन्फेंसी हैज बीन यूज टू सजेस्ट दैट हिज इन्फेंसी और हिज चाइल्डहुड वॉज एंजेलिक, इट वॉज डिवाइन, इट वॉज लाइक दोज ऑफ एंजल्स, देवतुल्य इन हिंदी. Because he was innocent and newly arrived from heaven. Further, he says, before I understood this place appointed for my second race. This place refers to this earth. The poet calls his life as a human being as his second race. Why? Because he ran his first race in heaven. So in this stanza, the poet laments for the loss of his divine sin-free state of childhood. He suggests that since he is an adult now, innocence and divinity is lost. Poem continues, or taught my soul to fancy out but a wide celestial thought, when yet I had not walked above a mile or two from my first love, and looking back at that short space could see a glimpse of his bright face. Taught here is the past tense of teach. To fancy means to think. Out means anything. Celestial means heavenly. Hence, the first line means he had not taught his soul to think anything, to fancy anything when he was a child, except a white celestial thought. White symbolizes purity, and celestial thought stands for heavenly thoughts, thoughts on God. The poet wants to say that his conscience was filled with pure and heavenly thoughts when he was an infant. White celestial thought is a metaphor for pure and heavenly thoughts. Here, first love refers to God. The poet says that since he had not moved far from his first love, he could see the face of God by looking back from that place. He suggests that as a child, we are near to heaven, and as we grow up, we get distanced from our first love, that is God. Such syllogistic style is one of the particular features of the metaphysical school. They try to prove their arguments rationally and scientifically. Further, he adds that in his infancy, he could see the face of God when he recollected about his past. When on some gilded clod or flower, my gazing soul would dwell an hour, and in those weaker glories espy some shadows of eternity. Gilded means golden. Here, cloud and flower are two natural objects. The poet says that the cloud is golden with the light of rising sun, and flower is a beautiful product of nature. Both of them are revelations of God's glory. And as an infant, he looked steadily on clouds and flowers, and in them he detected the shadows of eternity, reflection of God. But why does he say weaker glory? This figure of speech is called litotes. It is a figure of speech that uses understatement to emphasize a point. It states a negative to affirm a positive. The grandeur of the golden cloud and flower, both are powerful, but they are weaker glories in comparison to the strong glory of God, the divine infinite glory of God. Before I taught my tongue to wound my conscience with a sinful sound, or had the black art to dispense a several sin to every sense, but felt through all this fleshly dress bright suits of everlastingness. Wound means to injure or to hurt. Conscience, the part of your mind that tells you whether your actions are right or wrong. In Hindi, we call it antaratma. Sinful sound here stands for the language of sinful men who speak about immoral things of the world. Black art refers to black magic. Here it means knowledge of evil. Dispense means to distribute or allot. Several, many, separate, distinct. The poet here says that in his childhood, his tongue had not learned sinful sounds, hence it could not injure his conscience. He suggests that when we speak of immoral things, our conscience is injured. Again, he says that his sense organs had not learned to commit sins. He suggests that men commit different types of sins to gratify their senses only. The poet says, "This fleshly dress," he considers himself not a body, but a soul. His body is just a garment of flesh for his soul. Suits of everlastingness. Metaphor in suits could refer to rays of heavenly light or suits of a blossoming plant. It is a very compact and effective metaphysical conceit. Here, the poet presents a picture, an image. He says that glory of God shoots from God's face and enters the mind and body of the poet. Oh, how I long to travel back and tread again that ancient track, that I might once more reach that plain where first I left my glorious train, from whence the enlightened spirit sees that shady city of palm trees. Long here means desire something. Ancient track, old path of childhood. That plain, it refers to a place that is in between heaven and this world. And the glorious train means the band of angels in heaven. Enlightened in this stanza means emancipated or liberated. Drunk means intoxicated, someone who has drunk wine. And stagger means to falter. In this stanza, Vaughan says that he desires to travel back. He hates the life of worldliness and worldly sins. He thinks that by moving back, he can reach at heaven his original home. This journey is a retreat because we grow from infancy to puberty to adulthood. But here the poet wants to go back from adulthood to puberty to childhood till he reaches that point where he was separated from the glorious companies of angels. He suggests that as soon as the soul is born, it becomes detached from heaven and the glorious company of angels. Further, he says that it is the stage from which the enlightened spirit, the liberated souls, can have a view of heaven, their original home. That shady city of palm trees here is a reference from the Bible. In the Bible, heaven is portrayed as the city that has palm trees in it. So here the poet suggests that this world is not a place for him and he wants to go back to his original home, that is the heaven, and he can go that home only by treading backwards, only by making a retreat. In the next stanza, there is an exclamation, but ah, my soul with too much stay is drunk and staggers in the way. Some man a forward motion love, but I by backward steps would move. And when this dust falls to the urn, in that state I came returned. Urn means asthi kalas in Hindi. Here, the poet compares his soul to a drunkard. He says that his soul with too much worldly pleasure is unable to walk properly. In the next line, there is an antithesis. He says that people in general want to move forward, but he wants to go back in life. And he thinks that only when the dust of his body falls in urn, he will return to his original home. Thank you for watching.